The question comes up very often when I speak with customers about how do we secure WVD? To make sure that we're thinking about this holistically, we need to cover five major areas. First is to understand the virtual desktop service itself and what it requires and how we can secure that. Second is going to bring us to the area of network security, and those two topics are very closely related. The next area to think about is identity security. How do we control the fact that we've got a service that's globally accessible from any device anywhere, but still secure it when our users go to log in that those identities have not been compromised? Another area to think about is the security of our virtual machines in the cloud. These would be the session hosts in WVD. How do we protect those and monitor them appropriately? And lastly is the area of client device security. Because we can be using WVD from any device, you could have somebody accessing virtual desktop from their personal Mac device anywhere down to a computer at the local library. So we want to help you through all of these processes so that you can run WVD as secure as you need to in your environment. So for the next few minutes, we're going to dig into the service itself as well as network security as we kick off this micro series of securing Windows Virtual Desktop. I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy. With the new spring update now in public preview, the docs have also been updated, so I want to take a look at those quickly as we get started today. And from the main page of the Azure docs, we'll scroll down and open Windows Virtual Desktop. So now you can see the docs have been divided into the fall and the spring release. The spring release, of course, being the new ARM management interface. And I have received a lot of questions on our overview video of the spring release. So if you didn't check out that video, go click on it up here at the top, because we will be working with that today. But as I was saying, I've received a lot of questions around migration. How do I get from the fall release into the spring release? Or something like, I can't see my current virtual desktop resources in the new portal. What's going on? Know that this is a top priority for the virtual desktop product team, and we will be hearing more about this soon. So just stay tuned. And I would suggest for all of you who are still using the fall release that you use this opportunity using and learning the new portal so that when those migration tools are in place, that you'd be able to move over quickly, and that you would have little to no interruption of the service you're providing for your end users. Now, with that said, we're going to go back to the link of what is virtual desktop. And if we scroll down a little bit, we'll see the table that addresses all of the networking requirements around the WVD service. So whatever it is that we do to secure our network, all of these things still need to be accessible. Now, looking over at the right side, we've got a column here for service tags. Now, service tags in Azure relate to our network security groups, and basically they're a collection of IPs and IP ranges related to a specific service. So if you're using third-party tools other than what I'm going to show today, that's perfectly fine. But when you do, you need to make sure that you can hit all of these URL wildcards from any one of those other tool sets so that you can still access WVD. Now, what happens if your security department requires you to have specific IP addresses or not use wildcard URLs? First of all, this is not recommended in WVD, and here's why. The WVD service is highly resilient, scalable, and also self-healing. So if something goes wrong in the WVD service in the region that you're in, the service will fail over into another region or another URL. Now, it's always great to point out what other people do in the community to help everyone learn more about Azure. So say hi, everyone, to Roelf Zomerman. He's a cloud solution architect at Microsoft, and he's written a blog, which you can find at blog.azureinfra.com. And he's got a lot of stuff across many topics, one of them being Windows Virtual Desktop and firewalls. He covers the process here for how to build the firewall and use it to secure the URLs that we were just looking at, as well as an updated note that the Azure Firewall now supports FQDN tags. So a lot of these items that were initially here have been scratched off the list, and we'll cover more about what this means in a moment. But if you scroll down just a little bit more, you get down to this section about being more restrictive. Now, let me flip over to one of my VMs, and in the Windows Event Viewer, we've opened the application log, and you will find in here a event ID 3701, source is the WVD agent. And this shows the particular URLs for WVD that you are in communication with. So if there is some kind of issue in the current region, then the system would automatically fail over through DNS rerouting to another region. You may get another URL. And if you are only specifically whitelisting these URLs directly, then when something happens, that new URL may not be whitelisted for you and you would experience an outage. So it is highly recommended that you only use the wildcards. And then finally, he covers a section down here, how to set up your own proxy in case that's a method that you want to implement, as well as some required ports here for your Active Directory connections. So a great blog to go and check out, not only on this topic, but many others. Back in the main page of the Azure Docs, we'll scroll down to our networking section. We'll also quickly look at the Azure Firewall. And we have covered the firewall a few times as well. You can go check out one of our videos up here to learn more about deploying the Azure Firewall. Under the concepts section, we've got our FQDN tags. Now these are application rule related tags. And we've got a table here with all the current FQDN tags, one of which is now Windows Virtual Desktop. This is a newly released feature allowing Virtual Desktop to be protected through the Azure Firewall. And there is a specific link here for how we're going to go about this. So we'll scroll down a little bit and here's the basic graphic of how this is going to work. So the firewall is going to act as a security hub, which means that you can control traffic flow to your on-prem network, as well as other things in your Azure virtual network and things that face the internet like WVD. But when our clients connect to the WVD service, they're out there somewhere in the world, and that could be on your internal network or on the public internet. They're going to communicate with the WVD service. They need to then pass through the firewall in order to be able to get to your internal resources, like your domain control or your file shares for your FSLogix profiles, and we need to secure that flow from beginning to end. The firewall will also allow us to do some monitoring, tracking, and threat analytics based on how you configure it. Okay, enough theory, let's get to work. First thing we're gonna do to kick it off today is look at a resource group that I already have for my network, and we've got several items here. First, we'll go into our virtual network. And notice, first of all, that my DNS servers in this network have been set up to use custom DNS pointing at my private IP for my domain controller. Under the subnet section, I've got a subnet for the Azure Firewall, as well as a subnet for our WVD session hosts. Back in the resource group, let's dive into the network security group. And this currently just has a default configuration, and we need to set this up for virtual desktop. Let's go on the left here to our outbound security rules, and then we'll go to add a new rule. Source is going to be our virtual network. The source port range we're going to leave as star. Then our destination is going to be set to use a service tag. And there are a long list of service tags here. Some of them are just related to a service, while others are specific to a service in a region. And we can use this filter box here to find what we're looking for. So I just type in desktop, and then we can select Windows Virtual Desktop. And we want to configure our destination port as 443 using the TCP protocol. For our priorities, I'm going to make this priority 1000 just in case I need to add other rules to be more restrictive later on. And the naming convention I use is if this is allow or deny, then what the service is and what the direction is. So allow WVD outbound. And in my description, I've just put that the intention of this is to be able to get to the WVD URL wildcards. So we'll hit add. All right, and we're gonna add two more. And we'll use the same basic pattern, virtual network from any port going to the service tag of Azure Cloud on port 443, TCP allowed with a priority of 1010. The name is allow Azure Cloud outbound. And for this one, I've just put the URL that we're getting all this from as my description because there is a limit of 140 characters. So I can't list every URL specifically. We'll hit add for that. Two down, one to go. And this is gonna be slightly different than the other two rules because our destination is going to be an IP address rather than a service tag. And this IP address is the documented public IP of the KMS service for Azure. And it's going to use port 1688. And in my description, I've given it kms.core.windows.net, which is the URL that that IP address resolves to. We'll click add. Now that we've completed the virtual desktop settings in the NSG, I've also added a setting to allow the inbound and outbound traffic to my domain controller subnets and other private domain services. So in the new virtual desktop admin portal, we're going to go into my existing host pool. And this host pool does not yet have any session hosts in it.
So we'll go to generate a registration token, and I'll just make that valid through the end of the month. And now we'll go to session host here on the left, and then go to add at the top and build ourselves a session host. And all of this information is hard-coded because we're building into an existing host pool. We'll hit next. And because this is the first virtual machine that we're building, we have some more choices. First, at the top, I'm going to change the resource group that I'm building this in. I have a special one here for my host pool VMs. This is in the East US, and I'll change my size to my B2MS favorite. I'll just be building one VM right now, and I've got a prefix in here of WVD05 since it's the month of May. And we'll hit the drop down here for the image type, and there is only the choice for a gallery or storage blob. And the storage blob would be where you have a VHD file sitting in a storage account. And so if you choose that option, then you provide the URI to get to that storage account. So then the question came up of, well, how do I use my custom images? So for that, you go to gallery, which by default gives you the choice of three images. Your custom images can be found under clicking browse for all images and disks. Then you've got the choice of any image that's in the marketplace. Of course, WVD only supports Windows images. And for the specifics, you can go see the documentation. But at the top here, we have My Items, and this is where your Azure custom images would be located, or anything from the shared image gallery. Scrolling down, I've got my virtual network selected here, no public IP address required, and I'm setting the network security group to none because it's already attached to my subnet. And with my domain information entered, I'll hit next and put in my tags. And the tags help us to know who's paying for this, what application this is related to, and what the environment is. And of course, you can add many more, and we'll hit next here, and then you can review this process and hit create. And it looks like everything built successfully. Let's try to log in. I've got my WVD app open, and we'll go like our sign in for our new desktop. And there we go. We've got our profile all loaded, and everything looks good. And if I pull up the file explorer, I've got my Z drive mapped to my DFS server, and I can browse all of that space. And it all looks like my domain join was successful as well. So with our NSG configuration, we can now communicate with all of our domain services as well as the virtual desktop service. So an NSG is just an access control list. It's not intelligent like a firewall is. So if this is the only thing that you need in your environment in order to secure it, you're good to go. But we're going to kick it up a notch and take a look at the Azure Firewall. And in our firewall, we'll go to our rule set, and we'll go to our application rules, and we'll click to add a new app rule. And we'll give our rule a name of WVD, set it for a priority of 1000 and allow it. And then in the rule set, we've got a FQDN tag over here on the right for Windows Virtual Desktop that we've selected. Back in the document we were just looking at, there's a few other URLs that we need to have access for. So I'll copy this first one, and we'll create a new target FQDN for this. We'll just call it XT blob, or any IP address coming through on the HTTPS protocol to that target URL. And we'll repeat this for the other two. Now you can further restrict this if you have multiple subnets that are using your firewall by declaring exactly what your source IP range is. And I've also added an FQDN tag for Windows diagnostics and Windows updates as well. And when you've added everything that you want, then go ahead and click add. Now that that application rule is done, we also need to add a network rule because the application rules only work off of HTTP, HTTPS, and MS SQL. And we need to open that 1688 port for the KMS. So we'll give it the name of Azure KMS, set a priority of 1001, and set the action to be allowed. And the rule itself will be given the name of KMS from our source subnet IP range, going to a specific IP destination using the KMS address and port 1688. We'll hit add on that one. So now that we've got our firewall fully configured, what we want to do is disconnect our NSG and just rely on our firewall. Back in our resource group, we'll open our virtual network, go to subnets, and go to our WVD subnet. Now what we're going to do is disassociate the NSG, and now we want to switch over to using our firewall. So we need to add our route table, and we'll hit save. And while that's saving, I'm going to go to my virtual machine here, and we're going to restart our VM. That way we're sure that we're picking up all of our new IP settings. And just to remind you, the traffic flow from our custom route table says all traffic goes to the firewall. So in order for us to communicate back to our domain controller, our firewall settings need to be correct. And back in our firewall, we'll just go to our rules here and under our network rules. And I've also got a rule here for all traffic flow going into my domain controller subnet. So we pull up our client now and go to log in. And our connectivity still works, pulling up a file explorer, and I can still get out to the share, and we can pull up CM Trace or install any one of these other apps and access our files from DFS, which means our full connectivity to our domain is all working. So I hope you've enjoyed this first video in this micro series on WVD security and seen how easy it is that you can secure your network, but still enable access to the WVD service through our service tags in the NSGs or through the Azure Firewall, which will give you some more threat analytics and metrics. And of course, you can attach this to other services like Azure Sentinel or the Azure Security Center, and we'll dig into some of those in future videos. So if you thought that this video was good, please go ahead and click that thumbs up icon and let me know. You can also give me some comments down below if you have any questions on this or anything else across WVD or anything else in Azure, as well as leave me some suggestions of some other videos that you'd like to see us make. We'll be happy to do that. And while you're down there, if you haven't done so already, go ahead and click that subscribe button and join us here at the Azure Academy, where we're all just trying to learn more about Azure. And if you'd like to receive an email notifying you when our new videos come out, which is about once a week, you can go ahead and click that notification bell as well. We have been running some premieres on our videos when they're releasing, so feel free to set the reminder on those premieres if you're interested in that. And if you're looking for something more, over here on the right, we've got our latest video up here on the top, as well as a video that we've selected just for you to help you keep learning about Azure. Hope you've enjoyed this video and stay tuned for the next one in this micro series on WVD security, and we'll see you then. Happy learning.